Well, good morning once again. Welcome to Emmaus Community Church. We are continuing through our series in Exodus. Excited about this morning. I kind of titled the sermon this morning. I don't always title my sermon. Sometimes it's just like, you know, the text. But this morning, we're titled this morning is The Passover and the Pass-Through. We're going to take more of a high view this morning. Sometimes you drill in real deep and get down to a lot of details. And go into the depth of Scripture. And sometimes you got to take a 50,000-foot view in order to see the scope. Sometimes there's wider messages and wider themes that you'll see if you kind of back out and look at it from a 50,000-foot view. And this morning, that's what we're going to do. We're going to back out just a little bit, and we're actually covering two major stories where we probably could have done a sermon series on both of them, to be honest with you. But we are actually going to cover them both in 1 week. And really this morning, the reason that is because we see that God uses pictures to kind of help us understand. And actually to kind of help you understand how that might work is, I figured I'd just tell a little story this morning about, and it was kind of funny, I was joking with somebody's wife this morning who is in basketball season, and there's a joke about coach's widow. That's where the husband is coaching and gone quite a bit, and my wife experiences that during the fall, as you know, is because I'm a football coach and coaching here in Edgerton, but I actually also coached back in Lake Mills in our hometown. I coached when my nephew played, and my nephew thought for sure it was because of him that I was coaching, because he asked when he graduated, well, why would you keep coaching? So, well, you know, obviously, it's all about him, right? So, yeah, it was Ethan, yep. And so, back then, I used to be the pep talk guy in Lake Mills. Here, Coach Leitz does a good job of giving pep talks, but our previous coach in Lake Mills didn't like to give pep talks necessarily. So I had to be the pep talk guy. And so I would be the one that would give pep talks. And I like to give analogies and pictures for the kids to help them understand. And there was 1 week, we were playing in Poinette. Poinette was a team that I used to play in high school. The Poinette Indians were who I used to play against. And our kids came in at halftime, and we had a not-so-great start to the game. We were actually probably favored to win, and we were not winning. And we were having a hard time. And so what I did was I used the analogy of our team mascot. Now, if you know anything about Lake Mills, the mascot for Lake Mills isn't quite as big as, say, the Crimson Tide. It's a very unique one. It's actually the Lake Mills L-Cats. And the natural question that everybody always asks when they go to Lake Mills is, what in the world is an L-Cat? Nobody knows what an L-Cat is. And actually, the origins of that name L-Cat are from Hellcat. Okay, you can say hell in church, just so you know, okay? But they didn't like to say hell at school, so rather than calling themselves the Hellcats, they shortened it to the L-Cats. And the Hellcats were actually a fighter squadron in World War II that was a part of the fighter squadron. So I explained to the kids when they were picking the name of the Hellcats, the reason that they used cats was because of the viciousness of a cat. See, a dog, from time to time, if it is abused, it will actually, there are some dogs that may bite, but many dogs will actually, if they are beaten enough, they will actually be backed into a corner and whimper down. And the analogy I made for the kids is that would never happen with a cat, a large cat. And if any of you have cats, you know how they look at you, right? Like with a lot of sass and like they might want to take you out, right? Well, if you back a cat in the corner, the comment that I made to them is that cat will rip off your face, is kind of what I said to the kids. And my team looked at me and then just started to laugh, okay? And I couldn't figure out why, but then I realized that I forgot that the Poinette were no longer the Indians, that we were actually playing the Pumas, okay? And so I had used the same analogy that would have worked for them, and so to this day, my nephew still talks about the day that I talked about that a cat will rip off your face, okay? So it didn't work as well as I thought it would do, but when you look at those stories and you look at pictures to help to understand a concept, sometimes it's very helpful. And God actually does that with us. He actually will use pictures and stories to help us understand bigger concepts. And the main point of our sermon this morning is that God helps us understand spiritual and heavenly truths through pictures and stories in the Bible. And the Passover is a picture of the gospel, and it helps us understand what Jesus did on the cross for us. And when God led the people, Israel, to pass through the Red Sea, that's a picture of our journey to the promised land and our journey and our walk as Christians as we receive the free gift of salvation through grace by faith. But the Passover is how God got Israel out of slavery, and God's salvation is how he gets us out of slavery from sin and death. And the pass-through journey to the promised land is how God got slavery out of the people, and our Christian walk is how God gets slavery to sin and death out of us. So what we're going to do is we're going to back out and we're going to zoom out. But we see in Hebrews 8:5, we see in the first part of that, just the first half of the verse, it's Hebrews talking about actually the tabernacle and the temple. It says, they serve a copy and a shadow of heavenly things. And so what happens here is when you look at the construction of the tabernacle in the Old Testament or the temple back in Israel into Jerusalem, actually what this is telling us is that's a picture for us to help us understand what the throne room of God looks like. So God uses physical representations and physical stories to help us understand spiritual things, because spiritual things are not physical. God is not physical. Now, Jesus came as in physical form, but God the Father is not physical. He is spirit. So we cannot see spirit. You cannot touch spirit. You can see how spirit impacts the world, but we need a picture to help us understand some of these spiritual things. And like I said before, the Passover is a picture of the gospel, and the Red Sea is really a picture of our walk as Christians. So we're going to start off in Exodus chapter 12, and we're going to be going over the Passover. As you know, last week we talked about the 10 plagues, and the last one was that after the 9 plagues, after even his advisors and his magicians were begging him to let the people go, God said that the firstborn of all the Egyptians would die, and this is how God saved Israel through that judgment. So open your Bibles to Exodus chapter 12. We're going to be starting in verse 21. And actually, the text starts a little bit before that, but we're going to jump in verse 21. But before we do that, let's pray and prepare our hearts. Heavenly Father, we just thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to open up your word. Lord, that we thank you for the opportunity to be here in your presence, Lord, and that you would speak to us. Lord, we know that your spirit is in those that who believe you, and Lord, you guide us and you help us to understand. And so, Lord, this morning I pray that you would help get the picture of what the gospel is through the Passover, Lord, and what Jesus did on the cross for us. And Lord, that you would also help us to understand how passing through the Red Sea is a picture of our walk with you after receiving that free gift of salvation. Lord, I pray that this morning we would be impacted by that people would understand better, and that their lives would be even changed by your word. And Lord, I pray that you would be the preacher this morning. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, God sets out the parameters for what they should do during this Passover. And as in order to be spared from the pending judgment of the firstborn, it says in verse 21, then Moses called all the elders of Israel and said to them, go and select a lamb for yourself according to your clan and kill the Passover lamb. Then take a bunch of hyssop and dip it in the blood that is in the basin, and touch the lentils and the two doorposts with the blood that is in the basin. None of you shall go out of the door of his house until morning, for the Lord will pass through and strike the Egyptians. And when he sees the blood on the lintel and on the two doorposts, the Lord will pass over the door and will not allow the destroyer to enter your house to strike you. So this is the instruction that God gave to Moses. Moses is now transferring these instructions to the people. And we see in verse 28, it says, and then the people of Israel went and did so. As the Lord had commanded Moses and Aaron, so they did. At midnight, the Lord struck down all the firstborn of the land of Egypt, and the firstborn of Pharaoh, who sat on his throne, to the firstborn of the captive who was in the dungeon, and all the firstborn of the livestock. And Pharaoh rose up in the night, and he called his servants, all the Egyptians, and there was a great cry in Egypt, for there was not a house where someone was not dead. Then he summoned Moses and Aaron and said, "Up, go out from among my people, both you and your people. Go and serve the Lord as you have said. Take your flocks and your herds as you said, and be gone and bless me also." So we see here, the Passover is an event that happens. God pronounces judgment on Egypt. And if you were here last week, you saw how far it had gone and how hard Pharaoh's heart had gone. And we know that he had done wicked things. He had enslaved a people. We know prior to that, his predecessor had killed young children in order to try to control the population. This was a wicked man with a hard heart. And even after nine plagues that had really suppressed the people and hurt a lot of people, and there had already been death, he refused to give up his pride, to humble himself and repent. So finally, God passes judgment on Egypt. And this is the provision that God gave to the people of Israel in the land in order to avoid that. And we see this provision that was made is a shadow of the gospel. It's a representation of the gospel. And if we walk through this and we walk through the gospel and see how we see the gospel in the Passover, first of all, we must see that the gospel is the good news that Jesus came and died for our sins. But a part of the good news is that there's a bad news. The bad news is God is just. God is just, and when there is sin and when there is wrong, God must punish sin. There was sin in Egypt that Pharaoh refused to let God's people go. Pharaoh had oppressed and taken advantage of God's people. Pharaoh had allowed his pride to allow the entire land of Egypt to be hurt because of simple pride rather than letting the people go. So God, in his judgment, brought out wrath against that sin. Now, it might seem harsh, and sometimes when people begin to learn about Christianity, sometimes it might seem a little harsh to this idea of sin having eternal consequences. As we know, we are all sinners that fall short of the glory of God, and the punishment for that, it says the wages of sin are death. And what we need to understand is that the reason the wages are so harsh is because of who the sin is against. See, we have a holy and eternal God. And when there is sin against a holy and eternal God, the punishment will be eternal. The punishment for consistent and repeated sin against a holy God is his wrath. But the great thing is, God is not just, okay? He is also merciful. See, God is merciful in that he delayed his judgment. He delays his judgment. See, God could judge us, and he would be right to judge us even after one, sin. And he could have very well struck down Pharaoh and the Egyptians because they enslaved the people. And even after the first signs or the first plagues, he would have been right to go ahead and just in going ahead and striking down and seeking judgment against them. And yet God delayed. See, even in the garden, we see that when Adam and Eve partook of the fruit of the knowledge of good and evil, it said, "You will surely die," but in God's mercy, he delayed that judgment even in the garden. Death did come to man and sin did come to man, but it wasn't immediate. God gave time. He was merciful in giving time because God is patient. God is mighty patient. When we read through those stories and the repeated disobedience of the Pharaoh over and over and over and over again, he allowed even that things would get worse and that people would suffer in order to hopefully have Pharaoh's heart not be hardened. And yet we see even more so if you were to read the Old Testament, and if you are a person that's going through read the Bible in a year, you'll get to the point where you'll see over and over and over God's people in the Old Testament consistently falling away from God and falling away and going towards other gods, and yet God continues to be patient, he continues to redeem them, and he continues to restore them. So we see God's patience in the Passover, as there were nine plagues before this, but not only that, God gave a provision. He gave a substitute. Now I'm going to use a big theological word here. It's called substitutionary atonement, which basically means, the word atone means to pay for what you owe, to pay for your sins. Substitutionary means that somebody else does it. Next week, we are going to have a substitutionary preacher, okay? My wife and I won't be here, so Landon Flick from Lake Mills, if you remember, he was here not too long ago and preached. He will be preaching for us next week. So he is substitutionary preaching. But in this case, God provided a substitutionary atonement. Someone else would die and take the price for the payment. In fact, that's what we see Jesus do on the cross. And maybe you've heard that before, but we see the picture of that here in the Passover. See, God had said that the firstborn was to die, but instead the people could take a lamb, a spotless lamb, and they could sacrifice that lamb and take the blood and put it on their doorway. And in the same way, we see even once again in the garden that Adam and Eve, when they had sinned and they had tried to cover themselves with fig leaves in order to cover over their sin and shame, we see that God killed an animal to take the skin in order to cover over their sin and shame. And going forward in the future, after this, the Passover helps to institute a sacrificial system of repeated sacrifices in order to atone for the sins of the people. And maybe you've heard the word scapegoat. It's a term that we use in our culture that actually comes from that the people would put their sins, literally symbolically, when they would sacrifice the lambs, they would place their hands on them as if to symbolize that they were placing the sin upon them. And when they were sacrificed, that's what would atone, the blood would atone for that sacrifice. And so the blood, and you hear this talk, us talk about this during communion, that there's a blood covenant, that there's the Bible says there is no atonement for sin without the a shedding of blood. And so what they had to do was they had to take the blood of that animal and put it over the top of their door and on the sides of their door so that they would be covered by that. In the new sacrificial system, what they would do is they would take the blood of this sacrificial lamb and they would spread it across the Holy of Holies to cover over the sins of the people, that God would see the sacrifice rather than the sins. And so this was a similar action that they were to take, that they were showing that this action of putting blood on their door was an action of faith. There wasn't anything necessarily magic about that blood. It was the faith that they were putting in God's goodness and God's mercy that was actually saving them. It's similar to what we saw in the desert, in the wilderness later on, when the people were beginning to complain and groan against God and they began to get bitten by snakes, and God gave a provision to the people that if they would look upon this bronze snake that was put up on a pole, they would be healed. And so all they had to do was have faith in God, and that faith action that they would take would be to look up at the snake. And some would still not look up at the snake. And in the same way, God gave them an action to take to demonstrate their faith with the blood over the doorpost. See, they could not stop the wrath of God in any other way but to trust in what God had promised. So the wrath of God and the judgment of God passed over God's people because of the blood of that lamb. In the same way, God's wrath and judgment passes over us when we trust in the blood and the lamb of Jesus. And we see that ultimately what Passover did was it led to the freedom from slavery. It led to the Exodus. It led to them coming out of slavery in Egypt so they would no longer be in slavery. And in the same way, the gospel and salvation gets us out of slavery to sin and death. Prior to knowing Jesus, we are prisoners to sin and death, that we are unable to redeem ourselves, and we continue to struggle with things of the flesh and our own desires. And yet salvation, what it does, God, Jesus' sacrifice, it breaks that and it makes us free from that. Now, not only does it not just do that, and if we continue to read in the story, when they were sent out of Egypt, they did not just go empty-handed. They actually plundered Egypt. God gave them favor in the sight of the Egyptians and gave them silver and possessions. They left with great wealth, actually. And in the same way, God just doesn't forgive our sins. He also gives us his Holy Spirit and gives us his righteousness. And so when we look at the story of the Passover, when you hear about the Passover and when you see It still is celebrated today in the Jewish faith. It was something that would have been celebrated yearly. In fact, portions of the scripture that we skipped there were the instructions that they would do this yearly on a certain time of the year, a certain day of the month, on the first month of the year. And so Passover every single year for the Jewish faith is a remembrance of this event. And when we look at that, we see a picture of what Jesus did on the cross. So this picture we see is how God sets us free from sin and death. And Passover was how he set Israel free from Egypt. Now we see that they are set free and they go out. And many of you probably know the story of this next part of the Red Sea. And we see that real ultimately what happens here is God did the work of deliverance through passing through the Red Sea. In chapter 13, in verse 21 through 22, it says, "And the Lord went before them by day in a pillar of cloud to lead them along the way, and by night a pillar of fire to give them light, and they that they might travel by day and by night. The pillar of cloud by day and the pillar of fire by night did not depart from the people." So what God did was, leading out of Egypt, he gave them a sign where they would physically see God's presence through this pillar of either smoke or fire, and they would follow after God. God had done the work to set them free, and now he is asking them to follow after him. In chapter 14, verse 10, so turn the next page there likely, would be when Pharaoh drew near. Pharaoh had a change of heart. God hardened his heart once again, so he goes after God's people. And it says, "When Pharaoh drew near, the people of Israel lifted up their eyes, and behold, the Egyptians were marching after them. And they feared greatly, and the people of Israel cried out to the Lord." God had led them to the Red Sea, ultimately to the edge of the Red Sea. And where they were led to, there were there was a group of mountains, and then you had the Egyptians, and then you had the water. Quite literally, the Israelites were between a rock and a hard place. That God had literally led them to a place where they were helpless. And Pharaoh was coming down upon them, and he was attacking them, but yet God protects them. And in verse 13 it says, "And Moses said to the people, fear not, stand firm, and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will work for you today. For the Egyptians whom you see today, you shall never see again. The Lord will fight for you, and you have only to be silent." And the Lord said to Moses, "Why do you cry to me? Tell the people of Israel to go forward. Lift up your staff, stretch out your hand over the sea, and divide it, that the people of Israel may go through the sea on dry land." So God miraculously opens a way where only God could have done it. God put them in a place where only God could save them, and he saves them in a way that only God could do. In verse 29, it says, "But the people of Israel walked on dry ground through the sea, and the waters being a wall to them on their right hand and on their left. Thus the Lord saved Israel that day from the hands of the Egyptians, and Israel saw the Egyptians dead on the seashore." God allowed the sea to close in on the Egyptians, and it says Israel saw the great power of the Lord used against the Egyptians. So the people feared the Lord, and they believed in the Lord and in his servant Moses. So we see here, the picture we now see is the journey of the Red Sea, and really sequentially after this, I'm going to use kind of the Red Sea as the start of this journey. We see is really kind of a picture of how once somebody has received Jesus as their Lord and Savior, they've trusted in Jesus, they've received that sacrifice and asked for that to count for them, they now begin a walk with the Lord. And really, this Red Sea incident and the continuous journey towards the Promised Land is like our Christian walk and how we are meant to walk. And we see that in the story here this morning, that God led them out of slavery after they were delivered, and he led them by a pillar of cloud and fire. And God appears to them and leads them. And in the same way, God leads us as believers through his word. So we are able to open his word and see what he has for us. He is able to speak to us through his word, but he also speaks through his Holy Spirit given to all who believe in him. Now, the interesting thing is he calls us to follow, but at this point, he requires for us to be obedient in that following. See, God led them, but he led them to a hard place, and they needed to follow. Now, God led them to a hard place, but he protected them. He provided protection. See, the people had no means to protect themselves. Pharaoh had an army that would mow them down, and only God's grace would help them survive, and he did. He helped them survive. He offered a way for them to go, and they needed to follow, but that way was to pass through the waters. Sometimes God asks us to pass through the waters in the same way. God does protect us in this world. God does provide for us. He says that anybody who belongs to him will not be taken from his hand. There's not height nor depth, not principalities or powers or anything that can take us away from the love of Christ. But sometimes when we're following after them, we have to go to hard places. And sometimes in order to be obedient to follow after, sometimes that takes us through the water. See, God didn't just pluck them out of that situation. There are actually occasions in the Bible where we see some sort of teleporting happening. There's an incident where Philip is on the road in the desert speaking to the Ethiopian eunuch, and he speaks the gospel to him. This Ethiopian eunuch believes and asks to be baptized, and immediately upon baptizing him, when the eunuch came up, Philip was gone, and he was sent back to a different place, apparently. So God has the ability to do that. God could have taken his people and put them in a safe place just like that. But instead, he sent them through a place that would have likely been scary. Could you even imagine? I remember we used to have, it's still there, but it's called the Mill Pond in Lake Mills. It was a pretty swampy, nasty-looking place, and there was a boat launch there. And I remember whenever we would get into the boat as a family, it was just, I always was so scared to fall in because I thought, like, my sisters had convinced me that there were monsters down there and they were going to pull me under into the lily pads and in the weeds. It was just it's not a pleasant place to put your boat in, right? You wouldn't want to go swimming in there. Well, what they had to do was they had to actually drain that at one point when I was younger. And they found all sorts of things, bikes, I believe they found a couple of vehicles, all sorts of stuff in there. But man, when that thing was drained out, that was nasty looking. So if you could imagine, the Red Sea, which is wet all the time, is now all of a sudden dry. That doesn't mean that it was good, even terrain. It doesn't mean that it was good, pleasant place to walk. It would have been, and having water on the sides. I mean, on your right hand and on your left, anybody a little claustrophobic, right? Anybody ever get a little, Eli's a little claustrophobic, right? Now imagine there's walls of water. And I mean, how many parents would have been a little nervous about your little one, like poking the wall and then bursting it or something like that, right? I mean, that would have been a scary thing for them to do. See, God just didn't get them out of that. He asked for them to be obedient and step out and step forward. There was a need for prolonged obedience, even in scary situations, even through the waters. Now, we need to understand, too, that this is just the beginning of that story. This story of this journey to the promised land, this is the very beginning. God delivers them and helps them, but causes them to go through a difficult and scary situation. But then they continue to have to pass through the wilderness over the next 40 years in order to reach the promised land. And really what we see here is what God was doing was God had gotten them out of slavery, but he needed to get the slavery out of them. So let's just look at a few observations about the Passover and then also the pass through, the beginning of the pass through the Red Sea, but then also through the wilderness. So we're backing out to look at the scope of the picture here. And it says, when we look at the Passover and when we look at the 10 plagues, while Israel was in Egypt, this is one of the things as I was preparing to do this sermon series that really stuck out to me. That really, that whole first part of the book of Exodus is really about God and what God did. God does all the work for deliverance. God did the work of saving Moses. God did the work of the plagues. God gave the substitute of the lamb. God judged Egypt, and God delivered his people. All the people had to do was paint their doorsteps with the promise that they had believed in. So God was the one who did the delivering work. And in the same way, in our salvation, God is the one that does the work. We are not saved by our good deeds, and we're not saved by our church attendance or giving or serving or reading your Bible or praying or any of those things are not what save us. It is by God's grace and the work that Jesus did on the cross and trusting in that work that we are delivered out of slavery in the same way that the people were delivered out of slavery in Egypt. Secondly, once we have received that, God asks us to follow him to the promised land. See, salvation is by grace through faith, and there are sometimes some faith actions that we'll take, but the walk to the promised land is something that we need to do in obedience. We are to act out when somebody has received, God has called us to do certain things. Now, it is still spirit-empowered. There is not anything that we would really be able to do without God's empowerment, but we are spiritually empowered to be obedient to what God does. God puts the pillar out there, but we need to follow it. God puts his word out there, but we need to follow it. God gives his spirit, but we need to be obedient and follow. God asks those who belong to him to follow after him in obedience. And sometimes that is a scary situation and a difficult situation. Sometimes it means passing through the waters. The other observation I would make is that the Passover, when you look at the kind of the history here of God's people, relative even to this the book here in Exodus, it's a relatively short story. We're through it already after just a few weeks in this sermon series. Most of the work of most of the time we're going to spend here is in the wandering and the walking through and the passing through. See, God gets them out of slavery relatively quick, but it took, and that was, so God was able to get them out of slavery pretty quick, but it takes him 40 years to get the slavery out of Egypt. They needed to wander for 40 years in the wilderness, and even a generation dies before God gets slavery out of his people. So this morning, as our applications this morning, the first are, I basically have two questions here. The first would be, have you trusted in the blood of the Passover lamb? See, God's judgment is on man because all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. None is righteous, no, not one. Nobody does good by the standard of God. And we are all in a place of judgment, but God has provided a way, and he is by his grace, by trusting in Jesus, we can, like the people of God, we can paint Jesus' blood over the doorway of our life and judgment can pass over us because Jesus took that judgment. There's no wrath left for us because Jesus took it on the cross for us. See, that faith is an inward step and it is an inward thing, but oftentimes there are outward actions that come from that. But it is the faith that really ultimately saves us. So this morning, if you haven't put your faith in the Passover lamb, the first thing you can do is pray. You can pray to ask God. There's nothing magical about that prayer. There's no magic words that you necessarily say. It's the heart behind the prayer that you would say that you are a sinner who's unable to save themselves and in need of a Savior, and you trust in what Jesus did on the cross to save you. That's the first thing. And if you've made that step, the second thing would be to give testimony. See, God, the reason God wanted them to practice the Passover year after year after year is because they wanted the children to ask, why are we doing this? And they would recite the story of the Passover, how God saved them and judged Egypt. And so there's a testimony that should be given if you are a believer. You should be telling people that you have been saved by grace through faith. And then finally, another way, one more action that doesn't necessarily save you, but it's something you ought to do as an outward demonstration of the inward decision you've made is to be baptized. Baptism, if that's not something you've done as a believer, as an adult, that's something that you should do in order to show the world as a testimony of what God's done for you, that you have died with Christ and you arose again with Christ. So you can put your trust in the Passover lamb. You can pray, and then you should testify and be baptized. And then my next question is, for those who have trusted in the Passover lamb of Jesus, the lamb who takes away the sin of the world, how is your pass-through journey going? How's your pass-through journey going? How is your Christian walk going? How are you doing following after God? How obedient are you being to what God is calling you to do? Are you moving forward? You know, honestly, one of the biggest things when you follow Jesus and when you follow after God in this way, you need to have the right expectations. And I've got three expectations for you as you want to walk a journey of the pass through this world and to the promised land. Here are three expectations I would encourage you to have. First of all, expect God's protection. God does protect us. God has made provision for those who trust in him, that there may be challenges that happen in this world. This doesn't mean that you're going to have a life that is without trouble, but ultimately, God keeps those who he has saved. Those who belong to God remain God's. He will not leave us. He will not forsake us. He will take care of us. But also, we need to expect the rock and the hard place. Sometimes our obedience is going to be difficult. Sometimes God is going to ask us to do things that may be uncomfortable. Sometimes he may ask us to speak to a person and share our testimony with somebody. Maybe he will ask us to stop doing something that we know we ought not to do. Sometimes he'll ask us to walk in a place that we're supposed to go, and sometimes he tells us to stay in a place that is uncomfortable for us. Expect the rock and the hard place, but also expect to pass through the waters. One of the great things about walking through the waters, if they were fearful, the key was to not stop. They needed to keep walking. Maybe you've heard that phrase before, if you're going through hell, don't stop, keep walking. And that's ultimately what we need to understand, is there's going to be times that we're going to be in a rock and a hard place, but God will provide a way, and sometimes that's through the waters. One of my favorite verses in times of struggle and in times that I am struggling is Isaiah 34:2. It's an encouragement when Isaiah says it. It says, when you this is speaking to God's people. It says, when you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the river, they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through fire, you shall not be burned, and the flames will not consume you. So though the pass through can be scary and difficult, and it can be scary, God is for us and he protects us. Now, notice there, he doesn't say that you won't get maybe a little wet walking through the waters. It just says you will not be overwhelmed, will not be swept away. It says you may walk through the fire, but you won't be consumed. Doesn't mean you may not get singed a little bit. May not mean there might be not struggles and hardness that will happen, but God will carry us through. So let's remember that God has given us a picture of what he has done for us in the Passover. And when we see the Passover, we should remember that God made a payment for us, made a substitute for us, and through his blood covered over the doorway of our life, God's judgment passes over us. And in that, we become part of God's family and God's people. And we pass through this life, and we pass through sometimes some difficult things like the Red Sea, but God guides us by his Spirit and through his word, and we can trust him to protect us and not leave us or forsake us, so that we can know that we will enter into the promised land by his promise, regardless of what we see happening in these worlds today. So today, have you trusted in the Passover lamb, and how is your path through journey going? Pray with me. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for the truth of Scripture. We thank you that you give us pictures to help us understand the gospel and just the clear sacrifice of Jesus and how he paid for us and how we can put our trust in you for salvation, Lord. I pray that this morning, if any of us have not done that, that they would cry out to you now and just confess, Lord, I'm a sinner. And that I am in need of a Savior, and that, Lord, I trust in the sacrifice of Jesus, that it is sufficient to atone for my sins and in substitute for me, Lord. We just thank you, Lord, for that. And we just pray that you would help us to walk on that journey. And as we pass through difficult times and difficult situations, that we would know that you are for us. So who can be against us? And that you protect us and you guide us even in those difficult places. Lord, we just thank you and we pray that we would respond to that, Lord, through faith and then obedience in our walk towards you. Lord, we just thank you for that and we pray that this we would respond through this last song. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.